The Fairies of the Forest. Once there was a village right on the edge of a great and magical forest. The villagers had a very tough life and had to work very hard to get by. But in the forest, where there was much magic, lived the fairies, and the fairies helped the villagers. The fairies lived in the greatest, oldest of trees, the grandfather trees, and they spread their magic, music, and dancing throughout the forest. They would sing the flowers open in the spring, and they would sing the leaves into colors in the fall. They would dance through the snow in the winter, and they would play and frolic in the streams that ran in the forest in the summer. And they would always use their magic to make sure that there were ripe strawberries, that the forest floor was carpeted with edible mushrooms. They would play their music so that the apple trees on the edge of the forest would grow huge, red, ripe fruit for the villagers to eat. And in this way, the villagers always had abundance. This relationship between the fairies of the forest, with their glittering clothes and their sprightly little dances, and the hard-working villagers, went on for generations. Until one day, when a priest came to the village and built a church. And he lectured and ministered the people of the village, teaching them the higher truths of life. He said, "Now is the time to live as adults maturely and set aside the things of childhood. It is time to put away the tales of magic and fairies that you've learned from your nannies, and it's time to face life maturely. Life is cold and hard, and it takes a lot of work. And there is only really one thing in which you can put your faith. And that is the truth about reality that you learn from those of us who have studied at great length and who know." Well, the message didn't go over so well with the grown-ups of the village. But the children of the village listened, and over time, the children believed what the priest had to say. And in time, as they grew up, they held on to these beliefs, until little by little, people stopped going to the forest. And after a generation had passed, no one went into the forest. And the fairies, seeing no one, stopped making the berries grow, and the mushrooms, and the apples ripening, and danced unto themselves in the forest. But not for the villagers, because they didn't come. And this is how it went for many years. Until one year, there was a boy, a very different boy, born to one of the farmers of the village. This was a special boy, unlike his friends. He would watch sunlight as it would play across the drops of water on the pitcher his mother set on the table. This was the boy who would pick up the feathers that the blue jay had dropped in the garden. This was the boy who would spend hours regaling his friends with fanciful stories. This was the boy who would hear patterns in the raindrops on the roof. This boy had imagination and heard stories from his nanny about the olden days when the fairies danced in the forest and became curious. He one day went into the forest. And he looked around and went deeper and deeper. And he looked at curious things, little red newts and little white ferns that too grew brown when you touched them. And then he heard music and laughter. And lo and behold, the fairies had awoken, hearing the crunching of a human footfall in the forest, and broke out their musical instruments and danced with delight around the boy, who laughed with pleasure and delight and danced with the fairies. He danced all day until sunset, when he ran back to his mother and father's house. And there he regaled them with the tales of dancing with the fairies. His parents were aghast. His mother scolded him, and his father dragged him by the arm from the dinner table and threw him into his room, slapping him soundly and pointing an angry finger. He said, "You will not listen to fancy stories. You will not go into the forest, and I do not want to hear about fairies. There are no such things." The boy wept into his pillow, until his mother came in and said, "We do not want to hear this weeping. Give up these silly things." And he covered his head to hide his weeping from his parents. But the next day, he went back to the forest. Could it have been just a dream? He had to know. And there in the forest, the fairies again brought out their musical instruments, and they littered the air with pixie dust, and they danced around and around him, and they made him laugh, and they braided leaves into his hair, and the boy was overjoyed. He danced all day with the magical creatures, and they showed him the many delights of the forest. They gave him sweet things and beautiful things, and he put them in his pockets, and he went home. At the dinner table, he took these things out of his pockets, leaves, and brightly colored speckled stones, and berries that the fairies had showed him that dripped with juice, and he put them on the table, and he said, "See? The fairies are real! They gave me these!" His father was furious! And he threw the things into the fireplace, and he dragged his boy back up to his bedroom, and he hit him twice, 3 times, and he said, "Enough is enough!" And the very next day, they dragged him to the priest and explained the whole thing. And the priest said, "Leave him with me." And when he was alone with the priest said, "You have been a very silly, silly boy. There are no such things as fairies. You have brought home stones and leaves. Your imagination is making these things up. Listen, if you want to live well in this town, you will need to do 2 things. 1, you will need to work hard in the fields with your father. And 2, you will need to listen to your elders when they tell you what is real and what is not. I'll tell you what awaits you in the forest, my son. Only danger." And the very next day, when all the people had gathered in the church, the priest got up in his pulpit and he spoke with fire in his voice, saying, "In the forest you have heard tales from your nannies. I will tell you what really exists in that forest. It is peril. There are wolves, and there are wild cats, and there are poisonous things to eat. Children will put poisonous things in their mouths, and they will die. And wolves will tear anyone who go within the dark forest. For it is dark, and we all know that darkness is the sign of evil. Evil lives in wolves, evil lives in wildcats, and evil lives in poison. Do not go to the forest." And the people nodded their heads, for they had heard these words for many years and took them to be true. The boy did not go back to the forest for many, many days. It was a long time. But finally one day, he heard the birds singing, and he watched the butterflies, and they all seemed to fly towards the trees, and he got to wondering about the dances, and the playfulness, and the fairies, and he went back into the forest. And the fairies were there, and they wove him a beautiful jacket from green moss, and put it on him. And they brushed his hair with branches from trees. And then they laid out before him a sumptuous feast of fairy food, which glittered in the sunlight and smelled sweet like flowers and dew. And the fairies told the boy, they said, "Do not eat now, for if you eat our food, you will become like us. You will become one of us. You will live in the forest and wear glittering clothing and dance the flowers into bloom. But you cannot go back. You cannot return to your village, and you cannot be with your parents, for you will no longer be a human child. you will be one of the fae folk. So think and make your decision and come to see us again. And the boy went back to his parents. And he was wearing the coat of moss, and he showed it to his mother proudly and said, "Do you see this? The fairies made it for me." His mother tore the coat from his body and ripped it into shreds before his eyes, and when he cried, she slapped him and threw him into his room to await his father's return from the fields. And when his father returned, he was enraged, and he dragged the boy out behind the barn, and he whipped him. He got a willow switch, and he whipped him naked across the buttocks, the backs of his legs, and his shoulders, until there were marks aplenty and drops of blood from the boy's skin. The boy went up to his room and slept. The priest came to call at the house, and he told the father, "You have done right to beat him," in a voice loud enough for the boy to hear. And he said, "I recommend you beat him every time he mentions the forest. If he even so much as looks at the forest, beat him soundly. For that is the way to deal with recalcitrant children who will not learn their lessons. I will speak of this in church tomorrow." And left. The boy did not go back to the forest. Instead, he went to the fields with his father. And on the first day, he toiled hard until his hands were rough. And his father did not say a word to him. And the next day he went into the fields with his father and worked and toiled hard until his back was aching. And his father did not say a word to him. And on the third day he went again into the fields with his father. And he worked alongside his father, who said not a word until the very end of the day, when his father turned to him and said, "Good, this is good. You are working hard. This is right." And if this had been any other boy, it would have been good, for life and success do take hard work, consistent work. But this was not any other boy. This was the boy who collects the butterfly wings that have fallen by the side of the road. This is the boy with the Timothy weed in his teeth. This is the boy who presses leaves and keeps them in secret places, for they may bring magic later on. And so on the fourth day, the boy left his parents' house, and he went into the forest. And there were the fairies to greet him. Hundreds of fairies sitting on the branches, dancing amongst the ferns, wearing Lily of the Valley as caps on their heads, playing their instruments of silver and gold, and dancing about with joy. And they laid out before him the beautiful feast of fairy food that glittered with magic. And the boy ate, and ate some more, and ate yet again. Well, the father was curious why his son was not in the fields with him, and he ran back to the house, and he said to his wife, "Is he here? Is our son here?" And the wife said, "No, I have not seen him." And they both knew what had happened, and they ran to the edge of the forest, but did not go in, for they were afraid. And they ran instead to fetch the priest, for he was a man of power, and he would know what to do. Well, the priest wasted no time and ran to the forest with them, and they ran directly into the dark forest. And there in the midst of the forest, they thought they could see their son dancing with no clothes and with leaves blowing around him as if blown by the wind. And they ran up to him, but he was not there when they arrived. And the priest took out his books and began mumbling words from his book and threw about some sort of holy liquid on the trees and tapping the trees and the dirt with some metallic religious objects. And the parents just listened, and they thought they could hear on the breeze laughter and a small voice saying, "Can you see me? Can you see me dancing?" But they could not see the fairies dancing all around them in the sunlight.